If you are deciding which GPU to buy, your confusion ends with this video. Probably. This is Fact Check, the best guidance for your purchase decisions. But first, the premise is that we have limited information about AMD 6000 series, as no independent and comprehensive benchmarks are out yet. Bear with me for a moment while we go over all the assumptions that we are making in order to draw our pretty unambiguous conclusions. First, ray tracing scope of performance for the AMD 6000 series is pretty underwhelming, otherwise they would have showed something. 2. DLSS. AMD says that they're working on their supersampling real-time technique, while Nvidia already has a pretty good implementation in few games. By the time AMD will come out with their real-time supersampling feature, Nvidia will likely have moved another notch. So in the short, mid-term, Nvidia has an advantage in those games that implement DLSS2 well. 3. In the cases where Nvidia cards are not limited by their VRAM size, we make the educated guess that Ampere will have the lead in several worlds workloads such as video editing, rendering, 3D modeling, game development, and so on, especially if the application is CUDA optimized. All these assumptions will be challenged once the comprehensive reviews are out. With the limited information available today, and assuming the reality won't be too far off from these assumptions, the best choices are as clear as day. For professionals that need more than 16GB of VRAM, or more than 10 if the applications you're using are optimized for CUDA or the Ampere architecture, the 3090 is clearly the best option, and I'd say the only reasonable one, unless you need a specific Quadro feature. The 3090 is also attractive to 4K gamers that really have a lot of disposable income and just want the best, no matter what. This is the space where the 6900 XT lives as well. For what it's worth to their target audience, the 6900 XT significantly undercuts the 3090 by $500. The two main considerations that should be made when comparing these cards are this price difference and which architecture performs better on the specific games that you play. The 3080 is for the same professionals that we mentioned for the 3090, but with the crucial difference that all your workloads fit within 10GB of VRAM. It is also the best option for 4K gamers that value ray tracing and DLSS. Just bear in mind that you might in future games not use the maximum quality texture settings because of the 10GB limitation. If you're interested only in the rasterization performance and you're building a new PC with Ryzen 5000 and therefore are looking at the smart access memory boosted performance, the 6800 XT is comparable to the 3080. The $50 savings and the 16GB of VRAM in this case seal the deal in AMD's favor. But if you are upgrading just the GPU of your existing system and therefore can't use the smart access memory boosted data for your considerations, taking also into account that the games AMD selected are most likely favorable ones for their architecture, there is likely a gap in the average performance in favor of the 3080. So it comes down to what is the most performant card on the specific games that you play, and whether you're fine in giving up the super high quality settings that use more than 10GB of VRAM. Here, the specific benchmarks data can tilt the scales in anyone's favor. Again, this comparison falls apart if you value and put on the plate DLSS, ray tracing, or CUDA. For super high refresh rate at 1440p, the 6800 XT seems to have the best performing architecture. So while the VRAM advantage is lost, there is a performance delta in favor of the 6800 XT. With the data presented by AMD, the 6800 XT seems to be worth those extra $70 and 50 watts power consumption compared to the 6800. We have to see if the overclocking performances change these considerations. Despite this, if you are already stretching the budget to get to $580, the 6800 is a solid option. It is, in my opinion, with its 16GB of VRAM, the cheapest card that provides a good 4K gaming experience, and it complements well a 120Hz TV or monitor. Keep in mind that all these data are for the highest settings. You can squeeze out a lot more frames, as there are usually some quality settings that are not visually so impactful, but that can give you some performance uplift. You also might be swayed towards the 6800 if you have a small form factor PC for the quality of life improvements that 50W LEDs can give you. Another card that I think is great on small form factor PCs is the 3070. The 3070 and the 6800 though are not competing that directly against each other, because at $500, $80 is a pretty significant difference percentage wise. There are three points of view from which to look at the 3070. First is productivity. Let's say your workloads are optimized on Nvidia cards or CUDA, and your budget doesn't allow you to get to the 3080. 3070 is today the entry point to the amazing Ampere productivity performance. One thing to be aware of are the 8GB of VRAM. You can definitely manage 4K video editing, but even 2GB extra might be coming handy from time to time. And of course, they may or may not be enough for 3D modeling, depending on the complexity of your work. The second is 4K gaming, and here I think that the extra $80 to get to the 6800 are really worth it. 8GB is not enough for a so-called next-gen architecture at $500. The third is 1440p gaming, where the 3070 shines for being the cheapest new architecture available. The 8GB are no longer such an issue, and its performance grants a great gaming experience. Overall, I really like the options at the high end, and especially for professionals and 4K gamers, today we have more possibilities than ever. Unfortunately, $500 is a pretty high entry point. I think the market desperately needs lower priced options for the new architectures that are more value oriented. Right now we have a huge void under $500, and generally the older architecture new cards are not worth their current retail prices, in my opinion. The used market prices are also pretty high as a consequence, as well as for the low Ampere availability. Finger crossed for a 3060 or 6700 to come out soon. This is Fact Check, your best